Well, hello, everybody. Hey, I know some of you. What? Am I supposed to say anything? Hi. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Samir. I'm the founder of Molecule. And in case you are unfamiliar with Molecule, well, really two things. We bill ourselves as the world's most technology-forward ETRM company, one. And two, if you've been here a couple days and you still haven't heard of Molecule despite the 7-foot-tall banner sitting in the conference room, you may want to schedule an appointment with the eye doctor. I'm actually a little concerned. Molecule is a cloud-native ETRM. We handle physical and financial transactions across 50-plus commodities, including crypto and derivatives related to crypto and mining. Our customers are really interested in this subject. We think what we are seeing in the market is sort of the bleeding edge of, let's just say, the making of crypto into a more realistic commodity. And we have, we're seeing a lot of interesting things, and Pat and his team have been seeing them as well. So here to talk about what he's seeing is Pat McKinnon. I suspect that for many of you, he needs no introduction, but unfortunately, I needed an introduction to him. So here's a little bit about Pat. He started in the oil field, unloading trucks, working his way up through companies such as Oxy and CME, where he helped work on their weather derivatives. Spent the last few years at Euler Hermes, building the alternative assurance practice from scratch. And on the crypto side, he spent the last several years working in the market with CME Group and now the Redivider Opportunity Zone. We met earlier this week, had a fantastic conversation, and I can't wait to see what we talk about today. We'll have time for questions at the end, so please ask the real hard ones to him. And yeah, without further ado, here's Pat McKinnon.
Well, I'm glad the room got some people in it. Thank you very much for attending. And yes, you can play Stump the Chump at the end of this thing. I won't be offended. I'm happy to do it. My background, I'll often say, is like the worst managed career in the history of the energy business. But I do have 30 years out there. And just to background a little bit, I'm equity both on the production and distribution asset side for the gas business. And I'm also equity in the crypto business. So I own pieces of this, so it's a little personal to me. But what I have found in the market is that there's a great lack of knowledge and a whole lot of Wikipedia experts. That's not a good thing, right? And so when I was given the opportunity to give this, I relished it. And I'll tell you that I'm not typically a dais speaker in this small of the room. I'm usually sitting down and just having a chat. But that's how I'm still going to approach it. This is more of a conversation. I'm not going to try to impress anybody with my elaborate artistic PowerPoint skills, all right, I promise. You will notice that they're not there. And I try to use some themes that would be familiar to you. So on that note, when I start talking about crypto to people, this is the reaction I usually get. Hello, there it is, okay? Because they're unaware, they're a little bit scared of it. And because what they may be aware of is inaccurate, they're even more scared of it. So once you break this down, it actually becomes very simple and very familiar. So I'm going to spend the first part of this conversation talking to you about what it is. If I'm repeating or not elaborating for some of you guys who may be more knowledgeable, I'll apologize if this is redundant. It's not this guy, okay? Crypto mining is not this guy, all right? Crypto mining is more that guy. It is literally taking a whole lot of computing power and solving for an algorithm. That algorithm is actually pretty simple. It was written in 2004 by a guy named Finley, and it searches for an independent single-use string of hexadecimal code. Boy, doesn't that sound sexy? It's looking for an independent, unique string. It's called a nonce, a number used only once. That's what a nonce is. So you take that algorithm and you hit the Bitcoin network and you start looking at the nodes on the network, which anybody in this room could be a node. Anybody. It's a volunteer network of nodes and it's millions deep. Crypto was deposited on those nodes and you have to go find it. There's two reasons for that. First, the discovery process validates the blockchain. Did I just go over anybody's head? Say yes, it's okay, because it went over mine. Right? All it does is say that this particular distributed record, distributed ledger of record is accurate. So it self-polices in its accuracy, and it self-polices in the values that are available in the market. When you find this unique nonce, it is the beginning of the process to find the whole chain that's needed to create a digital currency stream. A digital currency stream, once you found it, you are rewarded with either currency or fees. So you've got a computer looking for a number. When it finds the number and it validates that number is independent and unique, then you get rewarded with a digital currency token. A token is nothing more than a unique data stream. Okay? But since it's processed and applied to a ledger that was validated a million times, it's not wrong. So it does have substance. It is reality, and it's very, very hard to affect. Okay? So with all that said, I'm sure there's some of you in the room with that reaction.
Right. I get it all the time. The biggest question I get with this is it's real? Hopefully by the end of this conversation, you'll realize that it is very, very real and very, very good if you're looking to optimize your assets in a new and better way, really in some cases. So all we do when we're out mining for coin is we take natural gas, turn it into electricity. We take electricity, whether it be from a bus bar or off the grid, or we take renewable power. And we take that power and we put it into a big room of computers or a small room of computers. A lot of my sets are containers. Think shipping container. They're about that size, right? Some of the outfits out there do acres of computers in a building. Huge energy consumption to do this. Why? The computers have to do a great deal of work to find these numbers. It's very, very hard for the computer to do it, and it was designed for it to be so. So there is what's called two things. There's a congestion rate, okay, and there's a difficulty rate. And they consistently go up until every Bitcoin is found. So the earlier you're in the game, the more you're going to be rewarded because it's a little bit easier early in the game. As it gets more and more difficult, the computing power required to do it gets harder, and you have to constantly upgrade your equipment to keep up with the difficulty and congestion rates. But that's really simple. That's all it is. We're taking energy, we're sticking it in some computers, the computers do the work, and we come out with money. Now, there's lots of bitcoins, like lots and lots and lots of them. It's kind of like the coin of what's happening now, right? And the way a Bitcoin gets created is a group of people get together and they go, I want my currency to look like this. I want it to act like this. All blockchain applications, let me go back to this. Never, never, never equate Bitcoin and blockchain as being synonymous. They're not. They are not. Bitcoin uses a blockchain technology or process to police itself and to exist. But it's the use of a process. It is not in and of itself. Bitcoin, or Ethereum, or Dogecoin, or any of them that are out there. They simply use that methodology to operate. Now, this is a small sample of how many coins are out there. You say, well, what's their value? I'll show you later how you can go look for yourself every day. I can show you on my phone for a lot of these. They have a value, but many of them, there's like 92 zeros in front of the decimal, right? They have very little intrinsic single coin value. Others, like Bitcoin, have $30,000 values. At one point, $60,000 to $65,000 values. So it is a market where the perception of the value is determined by the oldest rule in the trading business. Is there a bid? Is there an ask? That's what determines the market. No matter how much effort you put into a market to validate it, the value of that market is always the difference between the bid and the ask. And unfortunately for some folks, unfortunately for others, the market is always right. You can think what you want, but unless you can liquidate it what you want, that's not where it is. The market is always right. So there is a market for these, and you can find them, and I'll show you where here in just a minute. But these coins are created, bought, and sold every day by the tens of millions. And this is just a few of them. One of the other things we need to think about, is it real? Can I spend it? Can I go down and buy Coke with it? In my case, a bottle of wine. Well, the answer is yes. You can now have a Bitcoin debit card. You can now have a Bitcoin credit card. You can now use Bitcoin to support a loan. It's called staking. Okay, that's, if you want to write that down and look it up, it's kind of an interesting topic. And you get paid for that. You can literally donate your coin to a pool that will stake and underwrite it for a loan, and you can get a piece of the interest that's being built on that loan. Okay? I will show you later who's involved in that process, and I think it might shock a few of you about how and what people are doing this stuff. But it's becoming more and more fungible. It was over a decade ago that the guy that founded Virgin Airlines traveled the world on Bitcoin only, and he made a big deal of it. And it was far less accepted then. It was far harder to do. But he still did it. Today, you can do it every day. It won't be long before you're going to be buying airline tickets with this stuff. Okay? So it has become an acceptable commodity. A lot of that has gone because the Fed has now certified certain coin types as being fungible for use in the markets. And that's when the banks really picked it up, when they got the stamp certification from the Fed. But it's happening all over the world. So you will see now, like I'm planning a summer vacation, two of the hotels offered Bitcoin as a method of payment. You know, that wasn't that common, not only a couple of years ago. So what you're seeing is coin is becoming de rigueur. It's becoming something that people have and people want to use, and they're treating it just like money. And as long as they do, it will remain money. Do not think your dollar in your pocket's backed up by silver or gold. It's not. It's backed up by full faith and credit in the U.S. government. This is backed up by the full faith and credit of market participants. Its value is that which they perceive it to be. Okay? So it's important, and I'll show you in a minute, but it's also fungible, and we're going to talk about that in just a moment. What does it take to acquire Bitcoin? It takes hardware and software, real estate, and energy. That's it. Does anybody or anybody in this room work for a company that has any of those? My guess is yes. Thank you very much. Okay. I appreciate it. What that effectively produces, what the machines are designed to do, is create what is commonly termed as a hash rate. Okay? The machines are called, in the digital world, they're called solving hash puzzles. Hash is nothing more than a component of a number. A parsing of a number is another way to think about it. So you've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2 would be a hash of that number. 3, 4 would be a hash of that number. Put them together, you have a string. Okay? So it's called hashing. A hash rate is what these machines are valued on. So when you go out and buy the machine, you're buying it for its terahash value. How many trillions of iterations can it run in a second? Trillions. Alright? This goes up into the quadrillions and every other Greek, you know, or Latin format in front of billions you can think of, right? So it can, but this is really what you're getting. And this takes a great deal of horsepower to run, all right? You don't get rewarded every 3 seconds, let's put it that way. You have to be a little patient. I'll give you some markers that you might be interested in. In a $30,000 Bitcoin market, the acceptable rate of cost of recovery is between $10,000 and $15,000. So you think in terms of, what am I spending to get my money? Right? They really try to work on half. Depending on who you talk to in the Bitcoin world, and me, and I look at this all as like a giant midstream. That's my background. So I look at it that way. It's very much that mindset that I approach this market with. What does it cost me to get, you know, if I build X, what's my Y going to be? To me, 50% gross notional profit is a pretty good number. You know, especially if you came up in a trading world where 2% was a home run. Right? So it's interesting to me how the people that have been the genesis of this market have been almost what I would consider myopic for the market that absolutely is fundamental to their success, and that's energy. Right? If you go talk to most Bitcoin funds or most of the guys that are there, let's just say they don't look like me. Alright? I'll leave it at that. Let you figure out what that means. And therefore, a lot of the things that have been done have not necessarily been the most efficient or optimized way to approach the acquisition of energy for the purpose of hand, because they don't think about it that way. They say, oh, the cheapest I can buy. Well, we all do. But does that make real sense? When you look at a Bitcoin balance sheet for a lot of these companies, if you don't know how to look at them, there's a lot of hidden in there. Oh, we get our power for 4 cents. No, you don't. That's not your cost of production. They don't use the very same rules that we use every day to build a pipeline or to buy and sell gas. They do not use them. So be careful when you're looking at these companies. You decide to be an exterior investor, right? You've got to understand what they're showing. And it's not hard. Just, I hate to put it this way, but you got to look at them with a little bit of a larceny in your heart, right? Because there was a little bit of larceny in their design, right? So just be aware. So once we create hash rate, and oh, by the way, we'll talk later about the fact that that hash rate now has a value. I think you guys recognize it, right? When you're back in your software, you actually look at hash rate transactions and can copy them. That's a big deal. That didn't exist a year, 2 years ago, right? So you can literally trade hash rate. For those of you in the room that may be involved in the business from a commodity perspective, think hash rate the same way you think of heat rate, okay? That's the right way. So if you trade a heat rate, you should be able to trade a hash rate. Now, once you get a coin, you have to put it somewhere, all right? So there is such a thing like a digital vault is the best way to put it. It's called a custodian. And these are just a few of the ones that are out there. And these are on both sides of the pond. But there's plenty of places that will take your known physical coin identification number and put it in a vault and validate it, right? So you get it into a vault or you get it into an exchange. Now these are the US exchanges. These guys are pretty big. Crypto.com has quite an aggressive advertising campaign. You may have seen them on TV. Coinbase is doing the same. But they're an exchange just like any other exchange. They just specialize in cryptocurrency. And many of the things you can do on many of the exchanges you're quite familiar with, you can do on these. And it's not just in the US, it's all over the world. These exchanges exist. My partner in CleanTech, his son owns BitMEX. Okay? So there's a lot of opportunity to find liquidity, is the point of my commentary. Okay? A lot of liquidity is out there, but you gotta kinda hunt it down. And you gotta look at what other people are going to and what other people are doing. The fact that Coinbase is very consumer oriented to me is actually a positive, because no matter how much I put on there, there's a consumer out there that wants a chunk of it. So I'm a big believer that liquidity is key, and this market is providing an unbelievable amount of new liquidity to our markets in energy. These two cowboys are studs in their world. So the FTX is the Bitcoin version of the CME. Is a way to think about it, right? But the CME Group, who was my ex-employer, I used to be the director of natural gas for the NYMEX, we were talking about this 12 years ago. It was first approached to come in and do it. The powers that be decided they didn't think it was a lucrative enough market, so it didn't actually come into fruition until just a couple of years ago. But that contract design is essentially what we did over there. This is not hard, it's just new. Right? It's just, that's all it is. But when you get this kind of horsepower behind markets and they believe that that liquidity is there and they're creating the opportunity for that liquidity to participate in the market, it says something. And it says that this is true, real. This is a dated slide, but I liked it because it was so dense with names, I could kill a bunch of birds with one stone. But I want you to notice the names that are on here. And these people are participating in both Bitcoin and blockchain consortiums, which I'm not going to get into. I'll leave that to your expertise, Samir, every time. But, look at these names. New York Stock Exchange, USAA, Wells Fargo, New York Life, MFRC, I just like saying their name. If you go down the list, Western Union, money transfers, AXA in the insurance world, right? The biggest balance sheets in the world are committing to this market. The biggest in the world. It might be time to take a look at it. And don't do this, right? It might be time. Now, the good news is that it's not a market where the more people that come in, the less piece of the pie you have. Actually, in the Bitcoin world, the more miners there are, the more people participate, the better it gets. So everybody has an incentive to attract more people to the market. So in simple terms, here we go. This is where you're going to kick in. In simple terms, all you really need to think about is that cryptocurrency is a commodity, just like any other financial commodity. The dollar, the yen, the yuan, the pound, whatever you want to choose, cryptocurrency is just another commodity. All right? Treat it like that. Think of it that way. It will help you sleep at night when you're trying to do this stuff, because the vol is high. You know, if you get all NDA about it, it's got a very high vol with a very long payout. If you're into options, you know what I just said. Okay? Also, mining is a market for us, especially the midstreamers and producers. But not just the midstreamers and producers. And that goes across power and gas and crude to some extent. And I'll show you in a minute why. The idea here is to get this down simple, but when you're thinking about crypto, it's another tool in your kit. It is something that is fungible, it's something that's real, it's something that you may have an asset that can participate in. It is simply another way to optimize your book. It really is. That's you don't have to get any more complicated than that. Now, depending on what asset you want to put toward it, there's obviously you have to have the ability to monetize for that asset. That monetization process will be different for every person in the room. That's unique DNA to the person who owns it. However, it's being done around you, it's being done all over you already today. So when somebody asks you about crypto, crypto is a commodity, mining is a market. Okay, would you like to play? There's something about that guy that's just familiar. I just like the picture.
It's you at five. Right?
Yeah. So let's talk about how you can play. You can outright purchase and trade it. If you've got sharp traders on a trade desk, use them. There's lots of vol. Volatility is a good thing if you know how to play it. And a lot of the traditional rules apply. It depends on how much liquidity you want to donate to the market, and that could be a derivative of how much actual energy you are supplying to the market. But there will come a time when, just like a heat rate, this is going to be a mandatory dirty hedge in a lot of markets. Mandatory. If you got a ton of mining going on in your constituency, then you're going to have to go to catch crypto to cover the piece. It's time to learn how. The other thing you can do is directly participate in mining. I put two types of mining up here because they're predominant. I'm involved in both. One is direct production mining, meaning that you put a box behind the power supply and you mine for coin and you take the results. That's just simply putting the hardware and software down to do it. Pool mining is where you get a group together and you all do it together and you share in that result. Okay? It is common because it allows people to dip their toe in the water without having 100% commitment, which folks like. And you'll find that your partners in those mining pools are usually pretty stout, so you actually get a credibility upgrade on the way in that your management would probably really like. You're going to see more and more and more of it because not everybody wants to take a full bite of the apple at the first pass. Right? And that's just reality. People do. The other thing you can utilize crypto for is facilitation of stranded assets. Now, we've all read the Wall Street Journal accounts or the USA Today accounts of stranded gas going into a crypto mine. Right? You hear about it. It's something that people can digest and they think they know what it means. They don't. Crusoe was one of the first companies to do a successful model of this, and it was highly successful. And unfortunately, they put the round peg in the round hole, right? The gas was dry, the land was available, all right? The electricity and the infrastructure was there to do it, all right? And they had willing counterparties to do it, right? So it all fit together, and they were super successful with it. Other companies have tried to replicate it. The problem is, not all gas coming out of the ground is built the same way. So they go out and they say, well, these producers. And you even had people out there trying to go to producers and get their gas for free to share in the crypto. The problem with that is royalty owners and JLAs, right? So if you know what a joint interest billing agreement is, you'll know real quick that that can be problematic because the royalty owners want a certain amount of revenue for the commodity. But all of these problems are getting worked through, and it is being done. It does happen, and it is being done. So if you've got a stranded gas well and you can't produce your crude oil because you're tied up and can't get gas off the lease, this is a way to move that gas out of the way. It can be done, it is being done, it just depends on the quality of the gas. If it's super wet, pre-processing blows up the economics. That's it, right? So what you want to look for in this is the opportunity to move your commodity to a higher value market. That's really all you're ever trying to do. So if the index is minus, as sometimes it's gone in West Texas, well, not today, but obviously, but you know, $8, $9 gas may be your good number. And maybe the crypto mining operation can't produce it. Turn it off. When it goes back to two, turn it off. It's flexible. It's flexible. Infrastructure. Do you own pipelines? Do you own power infrastructure? Whatever your company does, is any of that not fully utilized? If it is not fully utilized, a dead tap on a pipeline with a couple of acres of leasehold around it is worth a lot of money in the crypto world. Because you can put a box on that, you can open that tap back up that you've already cut, you don't have to spend $400,000 to do it, and you can blow that gas into a generator, generator puts out electricity moves into the mine produces money. And it can be done in half a day. Okay? So it's an opportunity to take stranded assets of all kinds and optimize for them. And then, of course, energy. The example I like to use for this is, let's say I'm an IPP, independent power producer. Task is a great example of that. And I've got sitting out there with a peak load, with a peaking plant. Why couldn't I base load that peaking plant, sell that power off a bus bar, and run that plant all the time? Why can't I do that? There's no reason. If I have perimeter acreage at a facility, and I've got power supply to that facility that may be overplumbed, that happens a lot. If I'm overplumbed for that power, and I've got ancillary acreage, I can lease that out to a miner and share in those profits. I've utilized my property, optimized my asset. I've done more with it than I thought I could do yesterday. And it's all because the mine was open, and most of the time, the miners will take almost 100% of that risk for you. Okay? Most of the time, not all the time, most of the time. Right? So whether you just got a trading desk that has, you know, the mental power to go out and play the market, or you've got some infrastructure affinity and you want to go out and build your own capacity, or you want to share in the process of building that capacity, or you simply have stranded assets that aren't being utilized today, you have an opportunity to optimize those assets through putting them into a facility that's going to generate coin. Okay? And it's completely scalable. That's a crazy thing. Now, oh, my slide screwed up. Does anybody know what that is? It's a pickaxe, right? There's a reason. There's actually, this is a real term in the industry. It's called pickaxing. And all it means is, if you remember during the gold rush in the 1840s in California, the average income of a miner was far less than the average income of the guy selling him the pickaxe. Okay? So it's putting together the tools to do the project. So we literally have circumstances where guys are going out building these massive farms or even small farms and saying, okay, here's all the tools, I'll rent it to you for a piece of the reward. Right? You make less, but you didn't have to build or buy or capitalize anything. That's called pickaxe. Right? So that happens a lot. I mean, there's been announcements in the paper where guys are going to, I'm still trying to figure out how it's ESG compliant to put 200 acres under concrete building and call it. I don't get that, but there's one company that did that. Anyway, so there's lots and lots of opportunity going on. It's a little hard to find sometimes, but if you keep your eyes open, you'll find it. So to work it over again, this is a new market. If you're not doing it, you haven't done it. It's important to understand. It's a new market. It has its own dynamics. But fundamentally, they're all based in the same world we've lived in our entire careers. It's not something you can't comprehend. It's not, you know, techno-speak gobbledygook. Don't worry about that. Worry about whether you have the ability to use these tools to optimize for your own benefit. One of the things that's becoming a lot more popular, and this has been a big question, I wanted to address it in the room, is that who was fortunate enough to live here during Uri? Anybody? The rest of you were elsewhere. Good for you, right? Because it was no fun. But Uri and other events like Uri have brought to fore the flaws in our grid as they're created. The grid needs a lot of work in a lot of ways. Distributed generation is one of the things, which means just basically power production in very small places in very small ways all over the place. So rather than one big plant shoved into the grid, you've got about a thousand little ones. It's more sustainable, and the world's kind of headed that way, and they're looking for opportunities. I've had people argue with me, well, if you put up all these mines, you're just going to be horrible for the grid. You know, they're going to cut my lights off to run your mines. Well, no, because we're interruptible. I promise you, the moment that power makes more than my mine is making, I'm turning the mine off, and I'm selling the power. Okay? Think about what I just said. Which side of that don't you like? Okay? Either you're making money with the power in the mine, or you're making more money selling it to the grid. It's a free option if you're in this business. Even if you're not creating power through a genset of some kind, and you're just buying power from the grid, typically you're going to buy that power interruptible, so you get the better price while you're producing. If you look at a 3 or 4 year study on it, you'll find you're not down that often. Even in Houston, Texas, where we get hurricanes and Uri and all kinds of crazy stuff, it shuts the power down. If I had a facility sit behind the Astrodome, in the last 3 years I would have had to turn it off 14 days. I'll take that spread. That's fine. So what, and this forces the utilities to create more power. The market grows for them. It's profitable for them. Once they create that more power and you turn it off, you have greater sustainability to the grid. This is actually a load supporting activity. And don't anybody tell you different. If you didn't give me a phone, I'll talk to them. Because if I'm creating, let me give you another example. If I had been fortunate enough, which I was not, if I had been fortunate enough to have 50 megawatts available in 1 megawatt increments across the grid that was plumbed, that I could have turned off my mind and put back to the grid during Uri, do that math at $9,000 an hour. I would have been pretty happy. Okay? And I would have got paid. So that's the kind of interface that this market has for the grid. It's not deleterious to the grid, it's support. Right? So it's real important to recognize that. It also gives you a new optionality. You're planning a project. You're going to do a midstream project. I'm going to build a short-haul pipeline from A to B. That pipeline is meant just to get gas from the guy selling it to the guy buying it. That's all they care about. Oh, by the way, there's 200 acres in the middle of that. But that landowner's willing to lease. Put another tap in, add an inch to the pipe, and feed a mine. The mine will pay out the pipe. What does that do to your bottom line on the bill? Okay? It's integrated into your plans. It's a way to optimize for your position. It just gives you new optionality. That example I gave earlier about turning off the power when the power gets high, if you can take one asset making $1,000 a day, and you can, anytime you want, when the price is right, turn it to making $1,001, that's optionality. Right? And it's new liquidity. The people coming into this market are new buyers wanting more supply, right? Meet the demand for that supply is the business we energy people are in, right? To be able to leverage for that gives us more capacity on the grid that everybody shares in the benefit and the profits that are created there. Everybody. So it's a matter of, do I want a hand in this, or do I want everybody else to have a hand? Because this is coming. It's already here in very many ways. So it's flexible, it's scalable, and it's adaptable to your circumstance in finite and minute detail. It just happened. And again, there's firms out there today. I'll give an example. Some of the REPs in Houston, two that come to mind directly, have over a gigawatt each where they're feeding mines. And during the last power shutdown, every single kilowatt was turned back to the grid. And it kept people from, you know, going dark because the mines will shut down. We're not critical. We're not serving the hospital here. Right. And we're more than happy to take that low price for interruptibility. So it really is additive to the circumstance. So if you think about your individual circumstances, how could one piece of the supply, what would it do to your balance sheet to make an extra $2,000 a day with little or no risk? To you, because the miner took all the risk. All you did was supply power, or supply demand, or supply tap, whatever you got. Show us what you got. We'll figure out a way to refer it. pretty straightforward. So it works with stranded assets, underutilized assets. It's a method of value optimization. It's a value of monetization on your ancillaries. That comment I made earlier about perimeter acreage around an IPP, that could be Dow Chemical's perimeter acreage. That could be anybody's, because most of these facilities are overplumbed for energy supply. If you take a typical gas pipeline connection to an end user, it's overplumbed probably by double, because they built it for expansion that may or may not have ever occurred. Right? They didn't want to do it twice. So if you go look at those individual iterations that are out there, they're uncountable. there's just so many of them, they're uncountable. So as a tool for optimization, as long as you allow yourself the freedom to explore the opportunity, and you have credible counterparties you can deal with, then you're going to find. And there are some companies that are heavily invested in this that you may be doing business with today. I showed you some of the names. But believe me, CenterPoint knows this is happening, right? So does Entergy, so does TXU, so does South Texas Co-op, and so on. They all know what's happening because they're all feeding power to the market. So that brings up my favorite part of the day. Stop the chunk. Okay. I know you had some things you wanted to lead with, so I'm going to pick on you. What you got first for me?
That sounds great. Pat, this was pretty fantastic. First, just a quick round of applause. I think probably the best and easiest lead-in would be to start at the end. We talked a bit about sort of the policy debate around whether crypto mining at scale is good or bad for grid resilience.
Yeah.
And I'd just like to pull the string on that a little bit more.
Sure. Right?
So, yes, I think we all understand that that you can turn off a mine or a miner or a mining facility at a moment's notice, right, when the grid needs the power.
Mm-hmm.
I guess the question is, does it also support expansion of the grid?
It does, because if the power companies like to sell power, right? I mean, that's what they do for a living. I have already run into circumstances where load was not available to me. Right. No matter how much, it didn't matter what check I wrote. They just weren't going to do it. Where you see expanding the grid occur is at the nodal or micro level. So you might have a facility, one in particular that we're looking at now, it's got 5 megawatts of capacity already on it. Right?
On the node.
On the node. 5 megawatts of capacity. We need 50. Mm-hmm. Right? So our negotiation with the power company is, we'll put that 50 in. We'll pay for it. They didn't have to go to the rate base to do it. If you want to put it in, what's the cost per kilowatt for you to do that, or per megawatt for you to do that? If it moves my number by $5 or $10, mm-hmm. I'm not going to do it. I'll cap it myself, mm-hmm. right? And so, but they're willing to do that. Now, the only problem with that is that when that whole thing's over, am I going to take all that off? No. I have no need for transformers in my garage.
Right.
No. So what we typically will negotiate is a buyout price over time.
Mm, okay.
All right.
For CenterPoint, it will be
yeah. Whoever you're dealing with, yeah. You'll just say, okay, I'm going to put it in. This is a 5 to 10 year run for me. What's the depreciated value over that time frame? And you can have it for that. Sometimes that's a zero figure. That's a zero figure at times. So, yes, it does help support grid expansion. It helps support distributed generation creation. The key is that miner going to plug it back to the grid? All right, we have a policy that those come first. Mm-hmm. If I've got 2 trades, one can go to the grid, one cannot, I do the one that goes to the grid. Okay, so it's it is a supportive effort. In fact, Governor Abbott, took some heat for inviting crypto miners to Texas. Right? He did. There was a lot of negative press over that, which I found surprising, but when I thought about it, it's really just because so much of the world is myopic on this subject. He wasn't trying to sell them power. He's trying to sell gas, okay? He wanted mid-crypto miners to come in and buy the gas in Texas. Those of you that produce in the Permian are well aware of the challenges out there, right? So if you can bring a market that's at the wellhead, bring it on. Yes, sir.
So from a mining market standpoint, what do you assess the risk if people begin to take the newly emerging quantum computers and focus them on this, and there they put one of 10 billion current processors, 100 million current processors, there's only 2 million bitcoins left to mine.
Well, which will probably be done around 2100, the original date is 2140 for all the coins to be mined.
What I would tell you about that, remember my comment earlier, the more the better, right? You're validating more blocks, therefore there's more coin on the market. That's really the mindset of a lot of guys out here. Computing power is, as you well know, more power, the more costs, right? So there's a happy medium. And so far, most of the miners have been willing to iterate, right? So you go from X amount of terahash to the next level of terahash, they'll just make that iteration. I'm not seeing nor hearing. I've heard a couple of conversations about it, but from some incredible players, they're just happy to replace their blades, you know, as the next generation comes out, because it's economic to do so. It's really driven by, even though you can throw all that horsepower at it, it costs you 50 times more to put that level of computer on it, right? It blows your economics in the short term. And most of these guys are pretty short-minded. I mean, the 12-month payout is like forever. Yes, ma'am.
So, are you guys more focused on point solutions or upgrade solutions, particularly on West Texas, just community issue?
Right. So, for my group, we are agnostic. It's what are the economics, right? And so, I'm a field guy. I don't mind driving out to a lease, right? I kind of enjoy it. So those always fall across my desk, right, when those come in. But you'll find that a lot of the miners out there are specific. I can think of one block build that is building out 600 megawatts in West Texas right now. And they've got with four or five producers, and they agreed to an index floor for their cost of power, or cost of gas, and they're building out that infrastructure as we speak. So that particular company is very focused on production gas orientation. We decided to be a bit more agnostic because we're looking at opportunity zones for redivider. And opportunity zones tend to have a little bit of a profile. They don't always have oil and gas on them, right? And so sometimes you only operate them. So we're not going to make, we're going to look at the economics of trade. Okay. Yes?
So you've talked about Bitcoin, but there's also like Ethereum, gas, obviously. If we, in the unlikely event, are all migrated to the central bank digital currencies, do you think it'll be, what's your opinion on that? Will it be mining opportunities?
That's a really good question. It really is. And it has a long answer. Let me decap that before.
Mark, we'll talk about later,
but. Well, yeah, how long do you want to spend? It's like forever. Markets, those of you that come out of the commodities world will understand markets drive to the highest value, right? So the nature of the market is always going to be the drive to the highest value. Elon Musk can say all he wants about coin he's hot on. It's not going to be as stable, and this is a big word, stability or stable coin. It's not going to be as stable as one that's more displaced. So here's, this is going to sound really academic, but in truth, it's one of the fundamental reasons all this works. Cryptocurrency is the most small d, democratic currency in the world. Okay? You want to play it? Get out your checkbook. That's your barrier to entry. And that's it. You can either buy it, mine it, whatever you want to do, but the only barrier to entry is capital. Right? There is no other currency in the world that isn't affected by government policy. And while you may say crypto is affected by government policy, it's revenue. Yeah, you got to pay your taxes. Right? You don't get to deduct over this stuff. But it's not directly affected by monetary policy of the Fed, other than the value of the dollar you can create with it. So in and of itself, it's completely democratic. So any coin that comes to the market, I think they will resist a central bank concept on this. I don't think the coin developers are going to want that, because unfortunately, like in many things, remember I said the coin of what's happening now, they all think they're right. Everybody that uses the coin thinks their way is the better way.
Or well, they're like, they know they can scam from them.
Well, you learn how to avoid that. The concept of proof of work and proof of stake are your guardianship to that. The actual methodology of the way the coin is produced, you can smoke that out. If it's gainable, you can spot it. Okay?
Pat, what if we pull a string on that a little bit?
Yeah.
And let's imagine that the U.S. government does come out with a digital dollar.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think the architecture of that might continue to support markets like we've just talked about?
I do. This is, let me disclaimer this. This is purely Pat McKinnon's opinion. The digital dollar is really not much different than what you have today, with the exception that proof of work exists at a bank or the Fed or the exchange. It has a registration number. What is Bitcoin? It's a registration number. It really follows a lot of the same pattern. The guy that founded Bitcoin, Satoshi Nakamoto was his name. And by the way, the penny version of a Bitcoin, this is just so you'll, this is cocktail stuff. If you want to know what a penny version of a Bitcoin is, it's called a Satoshi. And as Bitcoin halves and becomes part of it, people will start buying Satoshi versus Bitcoin. So if the U.S. government were to come out with a digital dollar, in my opinion, it validates cryptocurrency permanently. Right? So to me, it's not a bad idea, nor is it competitive. And I don't think it's that big a stretch. Now, do I want to give up my pieces of paper? Absolutely not. I like carrying cash, right? That's because I was raised in East Texas really broke, right? So, it's just something I will do the rest of my life. But you look at a 25-year-old, you'd be lucky to find 50 cents in their pocket. Think about it. They're just tapping card, man, for everything they buy. I can't, I'm like, you know, bank statements look like this. So, that's a new world. The next generation is going to be digitally oriented, and their cash is going to be a piece of plastic. Right? The form that's on that plastic, as long as it's convertible to a common currency, I'm not a currency in what it did, which it is today, by the way, I could show you on my phone right now how I could take my demonstration account in Coinbase and turn it into U.S. dollars with two clicks. That's U.S. dollars in my bank account. Spend it. Right? Or I can put it in my E-Trade. So I've got opportunity. So I think that's going to be the ultimate validation. And I see it coming through the U.S. dollar, British pound, the major currencies in the world. Frankly, because it will give the government oversight. And that's what they desperately don't have now. So if they create oversight and they're still going to use that as their core currency, and the world does today, I think a lot of people complain that may change. I'm not so sure it will happen in my lifetime. I think it would be a huge boon to the market.
You might reduce some of the rent-seeking behavior from like Visa and MasterCard as well.
I don't think they like the idea.
No,
I don't. I would say that the digital currency market is a true threat to the current construct of the credit markets as we use them. Yes, sir?
Not a question, just to let you agree to what you said. I have a credit card, but it's looking hard to make
crypto. Right, there you go. Which one are you using, can I ask?
I'm using crypto.com right now.
Okay.
It's simple.
Yeah, it is. It's super easy to do. Yes, sir.
Bitcoin mining is obviously very electricity intensive compared to the other cryptocurrencies. Can you speak to some of the other ones, like Ethereum and maybe other ones, and kind of the magnitude of electricity consumption that they need to mine crypto?
Of course. Are you bringing this up because you're aware of what happened in New York State just a few weeks ago?
Yes.
Okay. For the audience, I'll explain. New York State, the headline read, New York State outlaws crypto. No. Or outlaws Bitcoin. No, that's not what they did. They outlawed a method of location called proof of work. All right? There's two major kinds of the way these computers go out and do it. One's called proof of work. One's called proof of stake. By the way, everything I'm telling you is infinitely explained in Google, right? I mean, you can find this everywhere.
Is there, also coverage, or is that?
There is, but it's not common, okay? Proof of stake is because it's what Ethereum uses, right? And it's the proof. So it takes less horsepower, hash rate, to go find a single unit of coin using proof of stake than it does proof of work. So New York came out and said, if you're not proof of stake, you can't mine it. Right. So they basically threw the whole ball of wax against Ethereum in New York. Well, the miners that were invested in it, I'm trying not to go here, but I'm going to have to for this conversation. Each of the blades or the computer boards that do this have what's called an ASICs chip on it. Okay? All that means is it's meant to do one thing. All right, it has one purpose in life, and it's coded on that chip. It's either Ethereum or it's Bitcoin. Some of them have multiple capabilities, but it's not like they can do 9, they can do 2. So what will happen is those miners with infrastructure that's paid out in New York will just swap to the area. Okay? The ones that don't are going to have to make an economic decision whether they stay. Either going to swap to Ethereum or going to invest.
As a, the margin on the Ethereum mining is, the structure is different, right? The architecture
is different. Right, it's proof of stake, right.
Is the margin narrower or is it just different?
It doesn't yield like a Bitcoin does when the final economic result, okay? It yields. There's plenty of miners out there doing it. It does yield. I know in our company, we're going to try to stake in a few megawatts of Ethereum. Certainly because I don't like being beholden to one anything, right? So, but Ethereum will be our choice. It's because the machines are available and they're efficient and they do a good job in that realm. Bitcoin is a finite resource, Ethereum is not. Okay, that's another major difference between Bitcoin.
Yes, sir. Small extension to that question. Can you speak to the different types of crypto mining that might be interesting to the individual or retail customer versus, companies that might have the power and capacity and, resources to mine for Bitcoin and Ethereum?
If I understand your question, is one guy in his wallet, what would he do versus what a corporation would? Is that accurate?
Yes.
Okay. All right. So one guy in his wallet. Well, you can go buy a machine right off the internet and plug it into your house. You have one? Yeah, what's your day rate on it right now? Do you know?
I'm at 2 terahash right now.
You're 2 terahash?
Sitting in my garage.
What's your yield?
I mine Ethereum.
Okay.
And at 2 terahash, I get 0.2 Ethereum every week.
0.2 Ethereum?
And I'm pulling.
0.2 is $15,000 a month.
Yes. And I'm pulling, let me think about this, 4 kilowatts.
4 kilowatts?
Yeah.
Okay, that's pretty cheap.
Yeah.
It's pretty cheap. 4 kilowatts, 60 cents, right?
Yeah.
It's still up to your electric bill a touch.
Oh, yeah,
sure.
My wife's not happy about that, but then when I pay the electric bill.
Right, you're paying it much more. So the answer to your question is an individual can do this. Here's an example. And I would say that that's not uncommon. You really did. I know ranchers that have them sitting in their barn, because they called me and said, which one to buy? Right? It's because their son walked in the house and said, I want a Bitcoin machine, so he bought it. But the guy's pretty happy once he sees he gets a few extra bucks if I feed him, right? So it's really, though, for the individual, depending on your level of market sophistication, for me, I treat the coin like a buying coin, right? For me, it's a long, I don't care what the price is. I care what it's going to be. So from my perception, I just mine and collect, mine and collect. But for most people, they want to convert it. So really, it's kind of smarter just to hold it in exchange, and let the market perform. If you want to physically mine, you can buy a box on any one of the dozen websites. Go mine. Buy one of miners tomorrow morning. And stick it in your house. Okay? So it does work across the spectrum. Just don't expect, $30,000 days out of the box. Yes, sir.
Can you talk about some of the operational risks for, say, co-locating a mine on renewable site or any kind of site?
Absolutely. And they exist. Right, they exist. First of all, you're giving up a piece of space to an outside counterparty. As a rule, that has troublesome issues you have to deal with all on its own, because my guy's going to operate lease, if you will. Not a lot different than if you have a pumper going to a wellhead. It's kind of the mentality you need there. Operationally, you have to follow, because you are running a great deal of electricity. You have to make sure that those requirements are met from an engineering standard, right? Delivering gas to a 3-inch pipe is not a huge deal, but the meter's got to work, right? So you do have some operational considerations. But frankly, they are no different than you deal with if you have an electric motor, okay, or you're selling grass on a split pipe, right? So if you've got a gathering system and you're selling split markets to different pipelines, it's no more complicated than that. You're just another market. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
And did I answer yours? Did I give you all your
name?
Okay. All right. Anybody else?
One more in the front.
I was going to ask. Last time I talked to one of these guys, I was talking to Bitcoin miners. Their strike price was about $200 per megawatt hour.
How much did you say?
$200. So he could mine profitably until the power price hits $200.
That's
but
correct.
This was when Bitcoin was around, I think at that time it was about 40,000. He might have had other costs embedded in it, like,
I promise you.
But as you coin more, like, it's gonna, you know, consume more electricity, right? So their struck price will come down. Am I understanding that correctly?
Okay. The way to think about what you're talking is what's your yield per minute.
Right, exactly. Right.
So that yield you're targeting is truly bespoke. I know guys that will shut their mines down if it's not affordable. Okay, so if I've got a $10 megawatt and I'm not making equivalent of 40 yield, I'm not gonna do it.
Well, how quickly do you think that will tighten?
Oh, it's going to continue to tighten until the end of the coin mine.
But is that more lenient, or do you think that will be more?
It depends on how many people enter the market. So I'm sorry to be evasive. I'm not
being
evasive. It really is contingent on how many players there
sure.
are. Now, what we found, and what I found really quite shocking, it's demonstrable, right? You can look at it on your dashboard. As the price of coin comes down, people leave the market because they spent too much money and the coin in their mind's unofficial. That creates two opportunities for me. I'll buy the mines, right? Fine, you want out? Come on, right? As long as I like the equipment. And that's really good. That takes power out of the process, right? Which is not good. So what ends up happening in this weird dichotomy, price of coin comes down, people turn off or get out, right? Price of coin gets up, you get this mad rush, but then the price of machines and infrastructure goes up. Okay, so either way, you're spending money. So the way to look at this is not in a quarterly mindset. As long as I'm profitable, I don't care. Because I'm always paying down that equipment. I know I have a recidivist rate from replacing it. I just factor that in. So the cost to mine a coin is going to go up. Theoretically, the value of that coin over time will be commensurate to that rise. So what you're really looking for is my cost of production, what's my ratio to my cost of acquisition. Or my value of production versus my cost of acquisition. And that's just good. They don't track linearly. It's silent on both sides. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Okay. Anybody else? Come on, this is a lot more meaty than that. Anybody?
All right.
Yes, sir.
Is there enough liquidity in the futures markets to be able to hedge for producers, right, to get more smooth revenue streams from your investments?
I know the answer, but
yeah.
You can hedge like, you know, a couple of months, but after that, there's no liquidity.
It's kind of a rolling hedge.
Liquidity spot.
You don't want to do that.
You don't want to do that?
I don't think the second roll is a topic you're talking about.
Yeah.
I was thinking about it.
It's probably not there with teeth. I will tell you that there are markets out there that people don't particularly participate in because they're unaware of. There's a lot of private over-the-counter markets. One of the big players in that is actually J.P. Morgan. Okay. They will make a market, and they will always make a market because they really don't care if it's Bitcoin. They just care if it's volatile, right?
Yeah.
They will always make a market, and they've been one of the front runners in that. That company I mentioned earlier, Blockfills, does do over-the-counter futures and options transactions, and they use the big banks to do it. And they've got plenty of liquidity within the year. But you want to go out 4, 5, 10 years. Anybody else?
Pat, I did have a question about just maybe less a market question and more a practical question.
Yes, sir.
You know, we were talking about how you can get, you can rent land or rent your, you know, node excess capacity to somebody who wants to come build a data center on your site. I'm just curious, what are these data centers like? Are they like the, you know, the cold, stable data centers of back in the day? Or is this like a trailer with just enough cooling to keep the thing running?
Wow, somewhere in between. Great question. If you walk into a field-dense data center mining coin, a modern one, there's two kinds. There's air-cooled and water-cooled. Believe it or not, it's water. The blades are under a liquid, right? That's what you have to do in Texas because of the heat. It seems to generate a tremendous amount of heat. So if you walked into one, it would look like a metal box, right? And it would have fans and blowers and crap on top. And you would walk in and you'd just see racks of servers, right? Or you would see immersion, they're called immersion cans, and the blades are sitting in those and just pure the water. It's like a battling brook. It's just, the fluid that's covering those is going through, and it's being recycled and chilled. It's Newfoundland has a facility because it's so cold there all the time, and the water's so cold, they just desalinate it right through it, right? And they don't really desalinate it.
I was saying, why bother desalinating?
Yeah, it's because it's heat exchange, right? And so if you actually immerse
the vapor,
right? So the heat exchange is more efficient than it is. But, so anyway, the answer to your question is it's a little bit more like the sterile okay. operating room than it is, you know, the pump jack.
Okay.
Okay. Any others? Yes, sir.
Are there capturing that heat that is being generated?
Really good question. That's starting to happen. You know, not too different than a cogen, right?
Yeah.
But you have to have a purpose for the heat. And the heat is higher than atmospheric, but not steam quality, right? You're not able to turn it over that. But there are applications for every place that heat's being recycled. You bet. Especially all these guys that are running turbines in front of the generators, because turbine stacks are 500 degrees. They're getting double recovery on those, and it's making the efficiency so high because they put basically a windmill in it. That turns them out again, which makes electricity in addition to the turbine, and then the heat coming off the top is recaptured and recycled for the purposes. Okay. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am.
We see a lot of energy storage being coupled with those to be able to tap in and more grid services.
Okay. If I own a big, huge natural gas storage position, pick Henry. Doesn't matter which one. If I own one, and I bought that position based on a price spread. I bought it in the summer to sell it in the winter. It's 50 cents. Let's use that as an easy example. If I can take that gas and make a dollar with it on site, I'm going to just blow it over there.
I'm talking about batteries.
Batteries.
Energy storage, batteries coupled with the turbine.
Here we go, Brother Elon. Right? The thing is, battery storage, I do not want to jump off this fence because I'm a lithium hater, so just, you know, but let me be agnostic. The battery storage right now today is not cost effective. Right. There's not a mass production, and it doesn't have the life cycle to serve the outage. Okay. So why would you use batteries? I'm going to make solar power during the day, and I'm going to run it 24 hours. That's a typical example. Right now, the efficiencies are not really there. We can get close, but it's really the cost of the batteries themselves that's so high. And as magnanimous as Mr. Musk is, he's lowering his price. Right? So it's one of those where as the price falls, you'll see more and more.
But let's say you've got a battery, right? Would you want the optionality of being able to feed a data center, or is really the optionality of the grid provides you sufficient and going to use all of your batteries?
Right now, the latter is true.
Yeah.
At Mr. Musk's rocket launching facility, they're testing the former.
Oh, okay.
That's what's good.
All right. Well, I think thank you, everybody, for being here today.
Thank you, Howard.